Hi, guys.
Sup, yo.
It's episode 268. Welcome back, and thank you for joining us once again for another terrific episode of the FUBAR Show program. But before we get into any of that, get your FUBAR Show swag at FUBARShow.com. Find all kinds of items like t-shirts, pillow cushions, mugs, magnets, and stickers in tons of colors and styles. Go to our merch page found at FUBARShow.com to check it all out. Next up, click on the link for SoCal rock band The Fallen Electric at the bottom of FUBARShow.com for music, tour dates, and merch. On Friday, April 8th, I will be at 3rd Street Tavern performing with a lot of other cool acts. One, namely, the guy, at least the guys who invited us, was Scotty Audio, and it's gonna be another good night of music. I just came off the heels of playing a festival last night over in Corona, so this one is gonna be another banger, man. So a lot of good variety kinds of music. Come on out. It's gonna be at 3rd Street Tavern in Highland, California. Show starts at 7. Lastly, Grass Door, everybody, now servicing all of Southern California and the San Francisco Bay Area. They're the best cannabis delivery service I've ever used, bar none. Go to FUBARShow.com and click on our Grass Door banner, and first-time users get 30% off of their purchase. Thank you to those who have shared or clicked on our banner and continue to show us some love. And now, episode 268, here we go. The Martini Studios in Ontario, California. It's the FUBAR Show. Hey, what is up, everyone? I am Joe C.
Oh God.
And Steph.
Thank you all very much for listening into the FUBAR Show. Remember to hit subscribe and be sure to rate, review, and tell a friend like a champ. You can also listen in and get our swag at FUBARShow.com. That's FOOBARShow.com. And follow FOOBARShow on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Instagram. Join in, drop us a line, and we'll foo it up like a couple of foos. Ain't that right, foos?
See, foo, see.
Yeah, man. Welcome back, dude. We took last week off. Steph, what the fuck? What are you doing over there?
I got tangled. My headphones were pulling me forward. So okay. I got tangled in the web.
Another entanglement in the news.
Yes.
No, man. So we take 1 week off, and one of the most beloved actors in Hollywood gets like shit on because of something stupid that he did at the Oscars.
You know what, Foo? As Chris Rock said, it was the greatest night in television history. And for those of you that don't know what the hell we are talking about, which you...
Wow, dude!
That's my new drop, dude.
Yeah, it's perfect. There's so many there. For those of you that are, you know, hiding under a rock or, you know, may have been locked up in a cave or dungeon for the last week...
What kind of dungeon?
I'll leave it up to your imagination.
Okay.
Not the sexy kind.
What? Oh, never mind. Okay. Jeffrey Epstein's dungeon.
Please no. You stop that right now.
No. I pressed the play button before any of that happened. I swear.
Got him in a trap.
All right. So Will Smith, right?
Oh, God.
And Chris Rock. And now, it's been talked to death on every other kind of platform. And because we took a week off, we haven't had a chance to really talk about it and digest it as a show. But Jesus Christ, am I right?
That was awesome, man. Mm-hmm. That was awesome and bad at the same time.
Yeah.
It's like I cringed, but at the same time I giggled like, oh, this is fucked up.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, oh,
it was a train wreck.
Like, this is real? Sure. This is real? Yeah. So, it's been everywhere. It's everywhere. Like at my building, in my office, we have like TVs in the elevator.
Yeah.
They fucking put it on there every single day when I get in. And then people in my office are starting to say like, oh, hey, did you guys see what happened on Sunday? Like, yes, we fucking saw. Everyone fucking saw. And the memes that have been coming out.
They have been fire.
They have
been straight fire, dude. The internet has given us the gift. Like, this just, I don't know, man, because, you know, we'll talk about this in the music highlights, but we recently lost a huge influential force in rock and roll music.
On your birthday, no less.
Yeah, my birthday on the 25th, we learned that Taylor Hawkins had passed, and then this rolls over like 2 days later, and man, it just brings up like the...
You know, I noticed a theme here, for uh-huh. say, with your birthday in particular.
Oh.
Even your birthdays for you mm-hmm. just suck. Think about it. Think about it. Hold on. Here's my evidence. Here.
Okay.
So 2016. Uh-huh. What did we do on your birthday?
What did we do on my birthday?
We went to go see Batman versus Superman.
Oh, for fuck's sake! You're right.
Fuck no. After
that. Oh my God.
2018 kind of was a blur. So I'll kind of. Well, actually, what did we do on your birthday, 2018? Huge party, I think.
Yeah, where people got drunk and started peeing on the floor. I think.
Ah, yes, and so falling all over in your bathroom, in the bathroom.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yes, breaking their collarbones. Yes, yes.
That is a, we won't bore you with the details.
No, but yes. I'm sure it's on an episode somewhere.
No, it's not. I don't think we've ever discussed it.
Then we shall not. Next, 2020.
That'll be a very special episode of the Foobar Show.
I mean, we just really even got to say 2020, and there you go.
Yeah,
you
nothing. I had Shakey's, right? Didn't I have Shakey's?
Yeah, like, because you ordered Shakey's.
The week that everything shut down, you know.
It's my birthday. Yeah.
It's your birthday.
It was the St. Patrick's Day when everything shut down, 2020.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And you know, and odd years are good. Odd years seem to be a nice even flow birthday year for you. But,
Yeah,
then this year. Jeez, dude. Just look, I got to look.
It was otherwise a pleasant evening, guys.
I was having a great time.
And then CNN gives me a notification and of course I'm the one to share it with everybody cuz I'm already like heartbroken the minute I see that, you know, that Taylor Hawkins had passed away. But well, anyway, we'll talk about that in the music highlights, man. I want to highlight him properly, but getting back over to Will Smith and Jada Pinkett, man. Let me play you a clip that I found. You know, we always jest and make fun of, you know, the more you know drop. It gets used quite a bit on this podcast.
Yes, sir.
Well, in 1992, Will Smith put together a PSA for NBC for the more you know thing. Let me play it.
Oh, there you go. Hey, check this out. Here's the situation. Say you out with your boyfriend, your girlfriend. You know, you're at school, you at a club or something, getting busy. All right, you're just having fun. Somebody steps up to you and they tell you they want to rumble. All right, now just stop for a second. Before you lose your head, get all crazy and toss your hands up, just think. The person that uses the head can always defeat the person that's just trying to use their hands. Now remember that, because the more you know.
Yeah, Will. The more you know, huh?
The more you know, Will.
Use
the
your head.
Never forgets.
Dude.
Pepperidge Farm remembers.
And let me disclose a little irony that, let's gloss over how like bad this particular bit was that Regina Hall did, where she was pretty much calling up a bunch of handsome Hollywood stars to come up so that she can practically grope them on stage.
Yeah.
I didn't watch the entire clip, but I understand it's pretty cringeworthy. But there's a 19 second window where she uses that bit to try to get Will Smith on stage as well. Let me play some of that because it's going to be like, all right, at this point, is Will kind of getting fed up with these jokes? Because, anyway, I'll let you I'll let you listen here.
Will Smith, you're married, but you know what? You're on the list and looks like Jada approved you, so you get on up here. Get on up here.
Because, you know, everybody knows that they're polyamorous.
I mean,
mm-hmm. And
yeah, they put their whole shit on blast like 2 years ago.
On that Facebook show that she has.
Yeah,
right?
Red Table.
The Red Table. Dude, if the ads for that, they're so pretentious, right? It's really just them doing a tight shot of everybody's face, like, and you know, while nodding, you know.
Yeah.
Like nodding very knowing, like, yeah, girl, I know mm-hmm. what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. I feel you.
Preach.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's just so pretentious.
It is. 100%.
But yeah, poor Will Smith was put on blast on that show when we talked about it too.
Yeah. Her entanglement, her romantic entanglement.
With August.
I forget the dude's last name, but
it's not important.
It's not important at all because he signed an NDA. And the only reason why anyone knows is because Will and Jada brought it up publicly.
On that show.
Yeah. And dude, ever since then, like, I'm sure Will Smith has just been getting blasted for being a cuck for, you know,
well, let's
no
not
reason.
Let's not forget, wasn't she also dating, like, in and like it was public knowledge she was dating that one singer, that one Latin American singer. Fuck, I forget his name.
J Balvin? No.
No.
Pitbull?
No.
Pitbull.
Fuck. Fuck.
It's a bald head. That's what does
no,
it.
No. Long, kind of scrawny guy. Because I need to know.
Oh, Mark Anthony.
Mark Anthony. Wasn't she dating him?
I think so. I mean, you probably, dude. Probably.
Yeah, dude. That's what. That's how I everybody found out. Yeah. It wasn't the Red Table shit.
No.
Because that was years ago. That was way longer than the August situation. Right. She was dating Mark Anthony.
Yeah, right. And then, dude, in the whole event after Chris Rock makes the G.I. Jane, which again is it's a bad joke. So I don't feel like a comedian should be punished like that for a bad joke.
It was a throwaway. Yeah. It was a jab more than it was a joke.
Yeah.
If you ask me. And you know, this is what worries me, man. And you know, I'm not saying I'm a comedian, but I'd like to stick up for that community because it's a pretty cool community that if we lose that art form, man, a lot of things are going to get real boring in our culture.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't want to make it okay for people to think that it's okay to approach the stage when a comedian is trying to do their job and just try to beat the shit out of them or smack them around and that kind of, I don't want to... There's stupid people out there that are going to feel empowered after watching Will Smith do what he did, right?
Listen, guys, violence is never the answer unless it's in boxing, kickboxing, UFC, you know, in the proper.
But that's a regulated sport,
yeah,
though.
Exactly. Yeah, I got to have some regulation there, you know? Or, you know, if you're just really, really drunk and your homies just, you know, have a pair of boxing gloves and be like, hey, guys, you want to have a backyard boxing match?
Yeah, get some sock and boppers, yeah, man.
Then you're fine. Then you're fine.
Use all the violence you want.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's still somewhat controlled.
Anyway, you were right about the Mark Anthony thing, but that was like years ago, like 2011.
But weren't they married, though?
They were, and then allegedly Will Smith caught him in their house with her.
Okay. Well,
and that's when the polyamorous relationship started.
Yeah, I guess he got a hall pass for, you know, catching him.
Yeah.
Right? I don't think it's a polyamorous relationship as much as it's just like, well, you caught me. Do you want to get divorced? No. Well, you can do whatever you want.
Yeah.
That's just way too many people in
but,
the mix.
But in that to that same effect, you know, you can't get upset when people make fun of you for something you publicly are bringing out.
Yeah.
I mean, bro. And again, the whole alopecia thing, regardless on if people knew or did not know, like, bro, he's a comedian and it's just a joke.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And he laughed. Will Smith laughed at it.
He did. You until he him. Saw her reaction.
Yeah. And then she...
Execute
she,
order
she
six.
Just quit. Six. She...
Do it. Do it.
Do it.
Strike him down.
Because she's like... There's that perfect shot where she's like rolling her eyes up in the back of her head.
Yeah.
Looks all demonic.
You know, it's funny because the memes that I've been seeing come out have been very reasonable.
Yeah.
You know, they're hilarious. They're brutal, you know, but they're reasonable because not only is everybody, at least the majority of people out there are saying, you know, yeah, he shouldn't have hit anybody. They're pretty much on Rock's side.
Yeah.
But at the same time, they're not really against Will Smith. If anything, it's putting him in like this weird purgatory of like, you kind of feel sorry for him, but then you're just like, well, you shouldn't have hit the guy.
Yeah. Yeah. No one knows how to feel about him.
Like, I think that's what makes this so fascinating.
Yeah. It's like, everyone loves him. Everyone loves Will Smith, and then
he's the fresh prince, man. And then he fucks
and
up.
And he
like
got
this.
Too fresh with Chris Rock. Yeah, can't get that fresh. Can't get that fresh.
Yeah, because you know a lot of the attacks are really towards Jada in a lot of these memes.
Dude, she's ruining his fucking career. Mm-hmm. Like ruining it.
Yeah.
Like just with the little things she says, the little things that she's. I mean, he's his own man too. Like. You know, let's not forget that he is a man and he's got to, you know, got to step up, brah, and realize when you're about to do something stupid.
Right.
But, yeah, man, it's been very interesting. And especially when you're seeing like the Academy, they didn't kick out Chris, you know, Will Smith immediately. Mm-hmm. And then they're publicly saying that, Chris Rock let Will stay. And then Chris Rock's people are like, no. Like, if anything, Chris Rock wanted to leave. Yeah. And the Academy's like, no, 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 please stay. Please stay. You have to stay. And jeez. So it's just like, so I got to stay here with the dude that just attacked me. And the dude's going to come be like, hey, what's up, Chris? So you remember that time when I just walked up on fuck. You? And yeah, come on, dude. Like, that's not cool. They should have just let him leave, man.
Wow, dude.
Yeah.
I got to say, though, Chris Rock handled himself probably the best out of anybody who
composed.
I could.
Oh, yeah.
Dude, he took it. He took it. On the chin.
And, you know? And a fucking mighty slap, too, by the way. Like, he cocked back and went for it, too.
Right.
You know, you even saw Chris Rock, like, you see slow stills of his hands behind his back, and he's, like, waiting for it because he sees it. He's like, fuck it, I'm
going to
take it.
You know, the wrestling fan community are saying that this whole thing was staged because in wrestling, you kind of, you tee up the person to hit you like that, and then you react in that way. Everybody's saying it, but like, no, the camera footage hit him. Like, it shows that it fucking got him.
Fucking made solid contact, man.
You can hear the smack in the microphones.
And you know what I'm most disappointed at, Foo? The most? Mm. I have not seen a single, what did the five fingers say to the face meme for this thing?
Oh.
Not a single one.
Well, I think that one's low hanging fruit. That's why the memes have been quality, because they've been out of like left field. All of them, all the ones that really you can appreciate, and get you that gut laugh.
There's that one I sent you. look at the Will Smith fight the way that Jason Bateman watches the Will Smith fight, and he's just like all excited, wide eyed.
Yeah, he looks like a kid in a candy store, dude.
It's quite the smack, Cotton. See how this plays out.
Hell yeah. We'll see what happens, man. He resigned. Well, I'm sure he was asked to resign.
Well, they're I know they are investigating, and they were going to, you know, kick him out anyway, so you know, get ahead of it, resign. Now I think they're potentially looking at taking away his Oscar, which is fucked up, dude. The one time, you know, he actually wins out of all these other nominations that he's had.
He should keep it.
Deserves it. That doesn't. I don't think it takes away from the performance, but they shouldn't invite him back. Yeah. Like, that should be it. They should Russell Crowe his ass. Like, all right,
you're done.
Peace. Ain't coming back. Well, Foo, we all would have wished that it was an April Fool's joke, but who really cares about April Fool's? Am I right?
Oh, right. Mm. Yeah, nobody cares about April Fool's anymore. If anybody out there cares, it's two people, Jimmy Kimmel and Jimmy Fallon, because they switched places on their shows this on Friday the 1st, and that was kind of cool to see.
It was pretty funny, especially when they were bringing in a lot of foreign fans in for like a meet and greet and pictures. And bro, like the amount of them that don't recognize or realize that either of them changed, I'm like, they're two completely different looking people.
Yeah, for those who haven't checked it out, if you go to YouTube, you can easily find this, where Jimmy Kimmel and Jimmy Fallon did this thing where they're inviting people on like a meet and greet to the desk, and when they're not looking, they'll switch places, so it's a different Jimmy. But sometimes they don't notice that another Jimmy has joined them on the table. Like, one has a beard, one doesn't.
Yeah.
One's an Italian. Well, I guess they're both Italian. But but anyway, you know, they don't look alike.
They don't. They don't look alike. They don't sound
very unique
alike.
Looking.
Yeah. And it's just like, there's a guy that they even had both of them on the chair at the same time. The guy had no idea what was going on.
I'm just like,
wow, dude.
Yeah. Yeah, man. April Fool sucks. Let's just be fair. It just sucks. Especially for adults. Like,
nobody wants to do it.
No one wants to do it. And if anything, it just pisses everyone off, especially people that regularly look at the news and, look
see
online.
What happened today?
Yeah, usually I try to avoid everything news related. So I was at the end of the day on Friday night, I'm like, you know what? Let's see what bullshit articles these guys put out today. So I saw one where it was like Robert Pattinson is exiting the Batman for Ben Affleck to return.
Dick!
And I'm just like, what? I'm like, okay, let me see where they're going with this. Immediately it says April Fool's news. I'm like, all right, I'm done. Like, really? Didn't even try.
No need to keep reading if they're going to put that on the front.
Yeah, like, not even going to try.
The one that I saw was Krispy Kreme was coming out with a perfume that smells like their donuts.
Oh, I'd buy that.
I know. That actually sounds really amazing, dude.
I would fucking buy that.
And it's funny because the bottle's in the shape of a donut.
Dang.
Oh, that's what's up. And it doesn't exist?
No.
Well, maybe it should.
Not yet.
I can just see you walking in the hallway, walking past stuff. Hey, babe. You're looking like a snack right now.
Yeah, I know. I know. The jokes that can come out of that are awesome.
Yeah, anyway. But fuck April Fool's Day. Let's just end it. And why is it considered a national holiday?
Is it really?
If I don't get a day off for it, it should not be considered a national holiday.
It's actually a worldwide holiday.
Shut the fuck up. Yeah. Then I get, give me my day off.
Shall we dive into a brief
history lesson?
Yeah.
All right.
Of April Fool's Day. There are several theories to why they think April Fool's started. One of them is when France switched from the Julius calendar to the Georgian calendar.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of starting the year or the equinox in January, it started in April. In the Julian calendar, the new year began with the spring equinox around April 1st. So they switched from that to the new Georgian calendar, which started on January 1st. And so people that were slow to get that change were called fools of April.
Okay.
Another speculation is that April Fool's was tied to the vernal equinox, or the first day of spring in the Northern Hemisphere, when Mother Nature fooled people with changing weather.
Oh, so same spirit.
Yeah.
Kind of.
And there's a whole bunch of like other type of histories. It's always tied to.
It's very cultural, not very pagan-y, like it, you know, we're used to hearing about from back then.
It depends on where its origin started. Like every country has a different story to tell. One of them is it's always tied with spring though, because that's just Northern Hemisphere.
Time changes.
Some people would send them out on errands to, you know, find this magical fish or bird.
The fuck?
And it just kind of stuck around. It just landed on April Fool's, or April 1st.
Mm-hmm.
It became known as April Fool's Day because people were gullible, and now we just wait for the stupid pranks to show up every year.
Well, people are still gullible because they still believe everything that happens on April Fool's Day.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Now we know.
And knowing is half the battle. G.I.
Joe! Thanks, Steph.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
No, you thank the internet, because thank you, internet.
Yeah. 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 I wanted to just discuss one thing. You know, Conan has been off TV for a little while now, right? He's actually gotten a lot of success in this podcast that he's been doing. Have you been listening to his podcast, Josh?
On
Do you
and
listen?
Off. Not
yeah, Conan old. O'Brien Needs a Friend. It's pretty good because sometimes he'll do Conan O'Brien Needs a Fan, and he'll, instead of talking to a celebrity, he just talks to one of his fans, which is also very entertaining, because it's Conan. He's just going to fuck with people, regardless of who it is.
Yeah.
So that's always cool. And, you know, he's got his ragtag team of sidekicks there. But fucking Paul Rudd. Paul Rudd has been known for a very long time to troll Conan. So every time that he goes on Conan's talk shows, rather than play a clip from the movie he's actually there to promote, he already set it up. Like, he talked about the movie. Instead of it being a clip of the movie he's in that he's promoting that night, it's always that stupid Mac and Me clip of that kid on the wheelchair. Going down the hill and falling in the lake, and then, you know, this weird alien thing comes up, and it's weird. It's a visual gag, right?
Yeah.
But Paul Rudd goes on Conan O'Brien Needs a Friend, and then he does this.
And I actually we've recorded it, if you want to play a little bit of it.
Sure.
And it's with Celia Weston, who's playing. We did a play years ago called Last Night at Ballyhoo, and I think, and this is where she is playing Gladys, who's the woman that's working in this store. I'm playing Ken, even though it's not Ken Marino, who is in the show. He plays Carl, but this is between Ken Croft and Gladys, and this is from our podcast. or an Audible podcast.
Oh, for Christ's sake. Why? Why? You can't do this on a podcast. There he goes. Wheelchair. You can't do that on a podcast. That's why I didn't see it coming.
Right.
Well, you can't do that on a podcast.
Yeah,
it's a visual joke.
I know.
I swear to God, how could I?
Well, that was. No, it's never.
It's an audio medium.
I know. Would it work that way? I don't know.
Was there any truth to anything you said in the setup?
No.
No.
None of that was true.
The joke continues. You had me completely fooled, honestly, because I didn't think. You can't do that on a podcast.
No, of course not.
You can't.
It won't.
Such a waste.
I think all she even says is Eric.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Eric!
Yeah.
Oh, trust me.
Anyway. Fucking Conan, dude.
Got him.
Got him again. I mean, and you know, this is up on their Team Coco YouTube channel for everybody to see. So, you know, they do record this visually, but it's consumed by and large by the public, you know, as an audio format.
Podcast, yeah.
So he did it again, guys. You would think he was done. You would think.
Mm-mm, nothing good stopped old, Paul Rudd, man.
Nothing. Nothing at all. All right. Well, that kind of improved my week. All that bullshit that, you know, aside from that Taylor Hawkins news, really brought some light to...
Leave it to Conan and Paul Rudd to to get us out of our little slump, Foos.
Yeah. Well, we got Geeking Out on tap. We've got the joint report. You got sports?
I do not.
You don't know? No sports?
Yeah.
All right. Well, no sports today, everybody. And then music. So let's get on with it. You guys want to start with Geeking Out?
Yeah.
All right. Here we go.
Introducing Marianne Ginger Snacks. Soothe indigestion, sore throat, cold, and cough with this tasty treat brought to us by Sherwood Schwartz. A Gilligan's Island reference in 2022? Is this even necessary? Why so soon, you may be asking? Well, we're here to look you straight in the eye with tongue to cheek and a wink to say this. Marianne Ginger Snacks. Find it in the Gilligan aisle.
Marianne Ginger Snacks.
What place did that one end up in?
That's nowhere near the top.
That's what I thought.
Mm-hmm.
Is what I thought.
Yeah, there's a few stinkers in there, man.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. It's as bad as the...
It's downhill from here, really.
Gilligan Coconut Memory commercial, or episode.
Episode, yeah. Well, that's good logic, man. If you lose your memory by getting hit with a coconut, you just need to hit yourself even harder with another coconut.
You know what, Foo? I didn't think about it that
way.
Yeah.
Ask any brain surgeon.
You know what?
They'll tell you.
That's what they did in Beer Fest.
Yeah.
That's what they did in Beer Fest.
Mm. They got drunk to remember something that they forgot while they were drunk.
Yeah. I do that when I'm high. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I learn while high, so that way I can stay high.
And then somehow Landfill knew some memories that, you know, his brother, the old Landfill knew.
But he's still Landfill.
Right.
Yeah, just for, you know, symmetry purposes.
His name was Gil, and you can call him Landfill too.
Yeah.
Foos.
That's good cartoon logic right there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, let's geek out about some actual good TV series coming out. So we've had two new ones. We had Halo premiere the week that we had off.
So I don't know the story for Halo, but and you're telling me that the representation that we're seeing in Paramount Plus is close but no dice?
It is not an exact recreation of the Halo video games. In mm-hmm. fact, they're serving this as a prequel. To when they first see in the first Halo game, and it's they're pretty much making up their own story. Not they have some elements in there, such as you know, the Spartans, and there was a rebellion that did occur before the Covenant started, you know, attacking a lot of the outer planets. Mm-hmm. And so in the way the game starts, the actual games go, is that they start off on Reach, which is the planet that you see in the series.
Okay.
And Reach is a hub for a lot of the outer worlds that the UNSC, or United Nations Space Command, works out of. And so they pretty much... in the game.
So the whole planet is like a headquarters to the entire Federation of Planets?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was in the actual game, it was more of a colony. Oh. They were colonizing it so that way they could build the headquarters there.
Okay.
So the UNSC had a substation there.
Mm.
But they get a surprise attack by the Covenant.
Mm-hmm.
And the Covenant actually used the very first Halo ring to destroy Reach. And then that's where the game begins.
Mm. Spoiler alert, now I don't want to watch the series.
Well, that may or may not happen in the series, because the series takes a little different turn. We actually are introduced to Master Chief in the very first episode, about half an hour in. You pretty much see the Covenant are on this planet called Madrigal that is being mined, and there's this rebellion faction that's going up against the UNSC, and they talk about these soldiers called the Spartans, which is what we know the Master Chief to be.
Mm-hmm.
So for those of you that don't know who the Spartans are, they are genetically enhanced soldiers, you know, essentially super soldiers. But the kick here is that some of them were actually kidnapped as children,
mm-hmm.
and made to serve in this program, and they've been implanted with chips that suppress emotion and suppress the decision-making. So that way they only do what they're ordered to do. They're supposed to be the perfect soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're given a lot of enhancements. Like you see in the very first episode, Chief, or like even in the opening, you see the scars on Chief's back.
Yeah.
From where they would, you know, do a lot of, you know, genetic enhancements and things like that. So you see his team, Silver Team, they're going in and trying to take out this Covenant faction that is looking for this artifact. And pretty much in a lot of Halo, it's based off of artifacts that this alien race is trying to uncover that eventually leads to these Halo rings. And on top of that, you find out that there's a whole history that humans don't even remember about this ancient civilization that pretty much created all of us.
Hmm.
So I don't hate the way they're telling this. I was just shocked at how far they went from the source material, at least from the main story.
So what you're telling me is that you think that it's garbage.
I actually think, contrary to your beliefs, Steph, I actually think it's really good. The first episode, I gave it 8 out of 10. Second episode, you guys haven't seen?
No, I haven't seen it yet.
But it's still around the same.
You're going to have to borrow your Paramount Plus password.
Yeah, I'm going to log it in
there,
for you guys. It's pretty consistent in the second episode. The one thing that has everyone up in arms, though, is the fact that Master Chief takes his helmet off.
I was going to ask you that. I thought he was going to die if he took off any of his armor.
No, that's not how it is.
It's not Darth Vader.
No. Yeah, yeah.
I thought it was like a respiratory thing.
No. They keep their helmet. They so in the video games and in the books, the Spartans keep their helmets on because they don't want people to know their real identity. So what it is the Spartans 1, 2, and 3, the first three generations of Spartans,
mm-hmm.
those were the generations of the children that were kidnapped.
Okay.
And that were made into that. So the program kept their helmets on because they didn't want people to recognize them
mm-hmm.
as the children that were kidnapped or, you know, or anything like that. So they kept them on. It wasn't until Halo 4 where you saw a new set of Spartans that were actually people that volunteered for the program.
And people knew who they were anyway.
And yeah, people knew who they were anyway, and they would walk around with their helmets off. But you would see them side by side with, like, Master Chief and his, you know, group of Spartans. His group never takes their helmets off. The mm-hmm. other ones are always having them on.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, so vice versa. But so that's why a lot of people were pissed, like, this isn't fucking Master Chief. Like, he doesn't take his helmet off for people, like... It's a whole
Mandalorian thing all over
again.
Yeah,
or the Boba Fett, like the Book of Boba Fett thing all over again. It's like, mm-hmm. why are they taking his helmet off? So that is where they're definitely taking liberties in the storytelling. They're kind of accelerating that part.
So is Master Chief supposed to be one of those kids that we're taking?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. And that's where you're seeing in this in the series.
Mm.
And that's what...
he fell asleep during the first first episode, so he doesn't.
I saw the first episode.
So if you explain for those of you that didn't see the first episode, when he grabs the relic that the Covenant were trying to dig up,
he's talking to me.
Yeah. As soon as yes, I am, sir. I am. As soon as he grabs it, you see that he has flashbacks of his childhood, but he doesn't remember even having that childhood. So that's where you're starting to see that we're going to start to uncover more and more as the season goes on that Halsey, Dr. Halsey, has been actually like brainwashing the Spartans to erase their past memories so that way she won't get caught. Like they want to keep, because these super soldiers are their only hope that Earth and the United Space Command have against defeating the Covenant. So it's a good series. I do recommend it for everyone. It's on Paramount Plus if you don't have it. Which a lot of people don't. They do offer, I think, a 14-day free trial. So I would suggest waiting until the last 2 weeks, the last two episodes, to sign up. That way you could just binge watch the whole series.
And while you're there, you go, if you haven't seen the South Park made-for-TV movies, it's not a movie. It's a made-for-TV movie that they put out on Paramount Plus.
Yeah, they're there, both of them. Mm-hmm. Parts 1 and 2. Mm-hmm. Definitely worth it. Well, Foos, that wasn't the only series we had premiere. We also had this last week, Moon Knight, episode 1 premiered on Wednesdays.
How'd you guys like it? I enjoyed the shit out of it.
I loved it. I loved it. It wasn't it started off a little like, wait, what the hell's going on?
It's a pivot from everything else they've ever done in Marvel.
Oh yeah, dude. I got like, it felt like a Memento slash like a cult horror movie.
Yeah, it was definitely creepy.
It was.
What was that? What was that movie with the guy who had those multiple personalities? Split. Reminded me. I had those kinds of vibes.
Yeah, that's
a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. A little bit. Yeah, I can't wait for episode 2. Ethan Hawke's character is pretty good too, especially when he like the opening scene grabbed me. Like where he has the water, smashes the glass, and he puts it in the shoes. I'm like, what the fuck? And he just puts it, you know, puts his feet in the shoes like nothing, and he like moves his feet around. I'm like, you sick son of a bitch! I love this. Where are we going?
Where are we going?
I'm following you.
What is this?
But yeah, and I love that they're doing a show about Egyptian culture and history, because Egyptian culture is pretty goddamn fascinating.
Yes,
you know, it's one of the oldest. And yeah, man, I can't.
Well, they already did the Norse one.
Yeah.
Now it's time to go Egyptian.
And they haven't. I mean, we got some Greek mythology with Wonder Woman. So
yeah.
Yeah, I really liked it. What about you guys? You guys both liked it a lot?
I liked it as a first episode. There's still a lot left unsaid, especially since we know nothing about Moon Knight. Right. We just like barely grazed the surface of what this character is. And it seems like with the level of stress that this guy's going through, you're going to really see the layers start peeling off.
Oh, dude, I was anxious as fuck when he was like starting to realize the shit going down. I'm like, dude, if that were me, I'd be like, what the fuck is happening? Oh my god,
people know him for other names, you know, finding a phone, and then all that shit. I'm fascinated, I guess is what it is, because I don't know anything about Moon Knight, haven't read any of the comic books. When you started talking about there being a possible show coming out, which now happened years ago, I was like, oh, Moon Knight, tell me more about him. I didn't. I mean, you kind of did give me like a description kind of intro,
right?
But I didn't expect this, and this is I'm like fascinated.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he's technically everyone always terms him as the Marvel Batman, and we haven't seen that yet. But I'm really interested to see if they even like give us that type of Moon Knight in this one.
I've seen the previews of some shots of like him in action, of, you know, leading in, they're promoting the rest of the season, but some of those clips that we haven't seen play out yet, or they look pretty cool.
Yeah, I think we're eventually going to start being introduced to Mark Spector, his other personality. Yeah. There's another one called Mr. Knight, which is the classy Moon Knight with his little suit and top hat and Kane. Yeah, dude, I think this is gonna be off the wall, like, great. I can't wait till we start, because like, for those of you that don't know, Moon Knight is schizophrenic. He suffers from multiple personality disorder.
That's a different thing.
Oh yes, a different thing. I'm sorry. Multiple personality disorder. Sorry, excuse me, everyone.
Don't let it happen again.
Oh. Get it right. So Tech, so far we don't know how many personalities he's going to have in this season, but I know in the comics it's what, three or
six?
Six.
Yeah, six.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
And not all of them have powers though, right?
They manifest for a different reason.
Whoa.
Yeah.
And so, it's usually to protect the host. Mm-hmm.
So from what I watched earlier, there is a personality one that is a millionaire, and that one's Mark Spector in the comics. Okay. He's a millionaire mercenary. Then you have, Mark Spector's the mercenary. Then you have Stephen Grant, mm-hmm. who was the one that's playing this one in this role as the little shopkeeper.
Okay.
In the comics, he's the millionaire. I'm sorry. He's the millionaire in the comics, Stephen Grant. And then there's a third personality. I don't remember the name, but he's a taxi cab driver. And he acts as the ears on the street kind of guy that like has his informants that come to him with information.
There's only so many hours in the day.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
You're telling me,
you're not sleep?
You don't, as you see, he does not. He does not.
That's right. He's always tired.
Yeah, he never knows when he is sleeping or not. Right. So... Yeah, I can't wait to see which more other personalities, because as you see here already, they've taken a twist on the Steve Grant persona. Instead of a millionaire, he's a shopkeeper.
Right.
So, you know, I'm wondering if there'll eventually be a millionaire component in there. I don't know how. I don't know how, but hey, you know what? Surprise me, Marvel.
Oh, I guess you both got it wrong. Oh. He has full-blown... Dissociative identity disorder.
Okay.
So that's what they're calling it.
Yeah.
Schizophrenia
is when you hear voices in your head, but you don't become those voices. You just hear that shit. Them. That's what schizophrenia is.
What was your favorite part in the episode?
When he wakes up in the Swiss Alps and.
That was a good one.
Yeah. When he like wakes up, he looks up at the window, the guard's looking down, he just waves at him, and the guard waves back like, hi.
Hi. And then they start shooting at him.
Yeah. what the fuck?
Run.
Yeah. Oh, man. And then especially when you start hearing Khonshu's voice, who's played by, what's his name? From
good old
Mythic Quest. CW. Yeah, CW's, I forget his actual name.
Yeah.
But he plays Khonshu, the voice of Khonshu.
That's who that is.
Yeah. Yeah. So what about you guys? What was your favorite?
He also does the McDonald's commercials now.
I'm not surprised.
The scene that really got me was when he's waiting for his date.
Oh, yeah.
And he doesn't realize, because he thinks that only one night has passed.
Yeah.
Right? Between mm-hmm. him talking with his date, setting up for the dinner, and then following up with the dinner, but a couple days has passed because of his,
disorder.
Yeah, disorder. He doesn't know what day it is,
and it just never occurred to him to look at what time it is or what day it is. And I just felt so bad for him because he really doesn't know what's going on.
Yeah,
right.
And it's so sad.
Yeah.
What about you, Foo?
I like when all the little ghosts start popping up.
Oh, like in the elevator scene.
He starts seeing that last, all that, those little jumpy scenes. That's what I like the best.
Yeah, it sounds like horror-esque.
Yeah. So it's a lot of genres kind of put in one. I'm excited to see what they do with this and how this is going to tie in with the rest of the universe.
Yeah, exactly.
How are they going to introduce, we haven't seen other characters come through, right? Not yet.
Not yet, and I think they said they're not really going to bring
no crossovers.
No crossovers, but they did acknowledge that this is in the same MCU universe. Mm-hmm. They just, but there was little Easter eggs.
So what blip happened?
Yeah, the blip did happen for sure. The Eternals thing did happen for sure. So I think there is an Easter egg for Atlantis. There's a shop there called Atlantis that they're saying. That's teasing up the Wakanda Forever appearance of Namor, who will be finally showing up there. And I can't wait to see what else they do with this. I like that they had the jackal scene where he was attacking him. He goes into the bathroom and then boom, that's when they finally unveil Mark Spector talking to him through the mirror. Like that was dope. And then his transformation, so I can't wait to see more transformation, more him in the actual Moon Knight suit. I think that's what I'm most excited to see.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, I think, well, and we're, like I said, we saw some clips in some of these promos that they've shot out, and it looks pretty good.
Yeah.
So, I'm, I, you know, they haven't done anything wrong yet.
They have my attention.
Unlike fucking DC, who pushed a couple movies out, and now The Flash is in jail? What the fuck?
Yeah.
Right?
Wait,
yeah,
what the fuck?
Yeah, he got too happy in Hawaii.
Yeah.
You know. He got
he threatened
much.
To stab somebody, right?
Yeah, and some people said he broke into their house. I don't know how.
What the fuck?
And he's been known to have like violent issues,
especially when he's drunk. Yeah. He's had some drunken disorderly issues, you know, in the past. So
get some professional help, dude.
Yeah, yeah, he kind of needs it. Kind of needs it.
And now his movie got pushed to 2023 March, I think.
Yeah, yeah, March 2023. Yeah, man. So Foos. You know, speaking of, you know, movies that got pushed back and didn't do well, let's get your guys' Morbius review. What I did there?
Yeah. Well, you know, we were looking forward to watching Morbius on the big screen. And then in the middle of the week, the Rotten Tomato review started coming out 20%, 19%. 18%. And right now, as we record this, the tomato meter is sitting at 17%. Now, one thing, and so I think, what was it, Steph? Was it Thursday where we're just like, all right, I guess we're not going if it's going to really suck? But then we saw the audience score come back. And right now, as we record this, is at 70%. A fucking chasm and such a disparity between the two, between the critics and the audience. So, what did we decide to do? We went to the drive-in. We decided to save some money, and actually, it was kind of a cool time.
Yeah.
I haven't been to the drive-in in quite a little bit, and I guess that's what we're going to do. If it's a movie where we're just like, we want to see it just so we can say we saw it and talk about it and shit like that for the pod, you know, do it for the pod. But I don't want to pay full price. and you can get drunk.
That's what Sundays are for, Foo.
Yeah.
Well.
Go see a matinee.
Nah. Nah. I don't know, man. I'm not much of a matinee guy. It's usually, when I go to the movies, it's usually in the evening.
Oh, yeah. That's right. You're never up that early to go to the matinee.
So we went, and I got to say, all right, for those who are poised to talk crap about Jared Leto, I have to say he did a good job. I liked his portrayal. I liked his acting. There was no issue. I have no qualms with Jared Leto. I have an issue with some other actors like Tyrese and Al Madrigal. Their dynamic was supposed to be a comic relief and do it for me. But even then, that can be forgiven if I don't get, I just get the feeling like this movie was written and prepared to be 2.5 hours. And somebody in the editing bay got too trigger happy, or the producers or the studio were like down this guy's throat to cut so much down to an hour 44, which is kind of rare these days for a Marvel movie, right?
Yeah. We're used to seeing Sony movie in association with Marvel.
And therein lies the issue, too. Yeah. I mean, we can add that to the list. I mean, how much time you got, guys? Because I just feel like this was a well thought out story that was just hacked away. Like the editing job that these guys did, and ladies, with this movie was just out of control, because I, at a certain point, I was more focused on trying to understand where I was in the timeline of where they were trying to tell the story as to actually paying attention to what the fuck was happening in this movie. Because, yeah, it takes you, right, Steph? It takes you like, in the beginning intro of a scene and where he's like going to that cave, and then it says like 20 years ago, and then you're expected to kind of follow it from there.
Okay. So the very first thing that happens is you see them collecting the bats for research, and then it jumps back to their childhood origin story, like how these two friends meet, and then it jumps back to the present. But that happens in so many movies that it doesn't take away from anything.
Took me away from it.
Like, how, though?
It just, I didn't like how they did it.
Because you have to give the characters a backstory so that you understand why they're doing what they're
doing. And somehow, I still didn't care.
But
because of the way they hacked away at the fucking the editing process in this movie, and Josh, when you're able to watch it on VHS or whenever the fuck you
yes, VHS. I'm waiting for it to come out.
Yeah,
you know it's coming back, right?
Waiting a long time.
VHSs are back, dude. Yeah. It's ironic, but it's pretty cool. When you're able to watch it for free on some kind of platform that you illegally download
TV,
you'll see what I'm talking about. You'll see what I'm talking. And I hope, and you know, and I think we only really are going to ever get this with the Snyder cut, but I hope there's some kind of director's cut at some point that really lengthens it up and fills those holes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Very Resident Evil-y.
First of all, you fell asleep.
5.8.
Again.
5.8. That's my rating. Okay, you take over my rant.
Yeah, I was about to say. Hold on. Let him finish before I hear your bullshit, Steph, all right? I want to hear him.
Listen.
A real review over here.
Well, and Steph, everybody, with a grain of salt, with a grain of goddamn... you're a huge fan of the Resident Evil movies. What other movies are like that? Pretty much it, right?
I'm sure. I bet you like the New Mutants movie.
I've never seen.
Oh, well, we haven't seen that.
Oh,
one
wow. Yet. Okay, never mind. I think she would like it though. It was just as bad. Go ahead.
There's a lot of other sci-fi movies like that.
Well, you know, I'm gonna keep going. My gripe with this too is that you know we've had at least a decade of really well-made movies, i.e., Marvel. I know this is not a Marvel movie, but that being where the bar is now set, why regress the genre back to a pre-Iron Man type of movie making? Because that's where we're at with this movie. It's like you're watching a superhero movie in the late 90s, early 2000s before Iron Man ever came out. It just has those vibes to it. Like, come on. Like, we've come a long way since then. It's not even campy. It's just not well edited.
No. I disagree with you there. Because if you watch the movie from beginning to end, everything makes sense. Yeah, there could have been more character development to make you care.
I don't think it's a matter of making sense is what he's talking about. I think what he's saying is a matter
pacing.
Of pacing and scene transitions.
Yes.
Well, it's because you wanted a longer movie.
No, necessarily. I just don't think that...
I did not mind the jumps because they didn't need to dwell on each particular scene for more than it was shown on screen. I think it was fair for what it was. Like, what you're watching is an origin movie.
Which are supposed to be exciting.
Are they though?
Every single one is. I just don't want to see Uncle Ben dying again. I don't want to see Martha and Thomas Wayne dying again. Aside from that, show me the fucking origin movie. I'm for it.
Right. So you see what's happening in the trailer. It's just that's exactly what you're getting in the movie.
Yeah.
Except for, and we discussed this on the chat, whatever Easter eggs were in that trailer.
That too. It's like, why
are not in the movie?
Why even fucking show them?
And that was the greatest April Fool's joke.
Oh, shut up. This was not on purpose.
It was on purpose.
This was not on purpose.
Because it's gonna live beyond April 1st. Yeah,
I thought it was a okay movie. It's an action movie. It's exactly what you think it's gonna be. I mean, there are two mid-credit scenes.
It's not a
which
bad movie. It's
been
a bad movie. I'm not going to say it's
other
bad
movies
movie.
Together.
Even though I gave it a 5.8.
5.8.
Let's all right. If you want to eat some popcorn and you want something to watch, yeah.
Watch something else?
Well, okay. What did you expect from this movie, though?
I guess I expected
it. Because we already know who Morbius is.
Do we? I don't know who this guy is. I don't read the comic books. I'm not you guys, pretty much. I am the 30% of the audience who didn't like it. Because I don't know, dude. All right. I liked it. It wasn't just good. It was good enough.
There you go.
How about that?
Oh, God. All right. So, Steph, what is your rating. Again, I haven't seen this movie, so I'm going purely based off of your guys' review here.
So I thought it was a fair movie, start to finish.
Okay.
The characters were fine. Acting was fine.
Oh, she's about to piss me off right now.
Mid-credit scenes, you know, are what they were.
Uh-huh.
Let her speak!
I'm the edge of my seat right here.
So I'm going to give it an 8 out of 10.
Oh my God.
Fucking damn it.
All right, so let's recalibrate here. Let's see where she's coming from. What did you give Endgame? Remind us. Do you remember what you gave Endgame?
What did I give Endgame? I think it was a 10.
Well, hold on. Let's recalibrate this recalibration. Let's focus on Sony movies. Okay,
would be more accurate.
Let's not put, you know, good Marvel's good name in such of a travesty of such Sony movies. For instance,
that's fair.
And the three
that's
Sony
fair.
Movies I want the three Sonys I'm going to use for calibration. Foo, here we go. Venom 2, and Morbius. So in which order do you rank those three movies?
Okay. And remember, in the chat,
yeah,
I redacted my statement.
No redaction here.
Been said.
What in what order do you put these three movies?
I put Venom first.
Okay.
Then I put Morbius, and then I put Venom 2.
What did you rate Venom?
What did I rate Venom? Oh, I rated Venom, what was it, an 8.7?
Son of a bitch. Fuck you. What? Fuck you.
What?
See? She's wrong. We automatically
hang on, Josh.
You.
Hang on, Josh. Well, okay. I like where you're going, but hang on. Hang on. If that's what she gave it, then that's her bar. Her bar is just lower than ours. So, by all accounts, she didn't violate your three-movie rule.
Okay.
Now, we do have to recalculate with reality in a way that we do with Fahrenheit and Celsius.
Yes. You know, let's do a conversion
right
here.
We have to do a handicap with yours.
Right.
So, you automatically get a... So, yours is a three-point handicap.
Oh, shit.
No.
A three-point handicap?
Yeah, Venom is not an 8.7. In fact,
I think we just divide by pi.
Okay, 3.15. I'll take that. I mean, a one. They're all ones.
No. Now we'll see what
you
we
realize.
Come up
I
with.
Like a lot of the stuff that you guys don't like.
That, well, right? that's where this is coming from.
Yes, that's exactly
I like a lot of those, you know,
from.
Very low rated movies.
Yes.
And thus your rating has a handicap. So in fact, let's be nice and give it a 2. You'll have a 2 handicap on all of your ratings from here on out.
What I don't understand is why
I'd be fine with a 1.5.
Understand is why you keep trying to compare Morbius to something like Endgame. Like they're just not on par with each other. They're completely different.
But
that's not what I'm comparing. I'm comparing your rating
to Endgame. So your rating for Endgame better be in the tens.
No, I understand. I understand that part. But when he was describing his, you know, review of Morbius, he was
don't
just like comparing.
Defend yourself.
I wasn't comparing it with anything. I just didn't like the editing. Mm-hmm. That's all I said. That's all I said. I said more things, but that's all I said.
Listen, so, I don't blame you for liking it, but don't
I feel
say
like
it.
I have to defend myself over the rating that I gave it because I like the movie more than you. It's like I'm being personally attacked.
Oh.
Well, that's every day on this podcast, so, you know, I mean, you kind of had just...
No, well, that's not where I'm coming from, Steph. I didn't like the editing. That's all it is. And the choices with some of the banter that was supposed to be the comic relief.
It's not supposed to be ha-ha funny.
Yeah, I guess.
It's not that type of movie. It's supposed to have like a darker undertone, but, you know, still...
Yeah, I don't. It just. I guess it wasn't for me.
Would you say that Steph's in a comic entanglement?
No.
Oh, oh well.
Yeah.
That didn't catch.
Okay.
So Steph,
just watch it. Just watch the movie.
I'll watch it at some point.
It's not long.
I'll watch it at some point. So here, Steph, to kind of make you feel a little better. It's not that your ratings your ratings are all bad because you do have some good ratings. It's that you're just throwing off the curve. You're the dickhead in class that like everyone gets a 50 mm-hmm. and she's like, okay, we're graded on the curve. And you're the asshole that fucking puts up a 90%.
That's exactly
throwing it
how
up.
It was.
It's like, you son of a fucking bitch. I need this.
Or game. You know how
I'm
like
retake it in the summer.
You know how like the meeting's almost over? And does anybody have any questions? Oh yeah, I got one more question.
Yeah, that's you.
And you just if there was like infrared in that room when somebody raises their hand for the question, you'll see like everybody release like breath, like a breath from their nose, like yeah,
dragon's breath everywhere.
So Steph, go back to the room, recalibrate. Just recalibrate, you know?
It's been calibrated.
We don't mind you liking movies. You can like whatever the fuck you want. I don't care. Just give it a reasonable and logical rating. Logical. It needs to be logical. Not phenomenal, just logical.
No, I've already said what I needed to say about this movie.
All right. That's fine. Okay, we can move forward.
Yeah, yeah.
He's about to lose his shit.
No, I'm fine. I'm perfectly
divorce!
Fine. No.
Slaps it down on the table. Where the fuck did that come from?
Slapping it like Will Smith. Hey-o.
Well, the Foo wanted to end his podcast over this one movie.
It's not even here.
Yeah.
When it, he resigned without telling us he resigned
yeah.
Years ago.
And now he's trying to do one
play
of
me
these-
off, Johnny.
That's the Foo.
But you know, he was so obsessed with this movie. He can't let it go.
That he hasn't seen.
Yeah. And he's the asshole that's giving like Spider-Man No Way Home and all these other ones shitty ratings. Like both of you just.
Look, I wasn't the one that gave Batman a 7.4.
Don't.
I promoted it to a 7.6.
You shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck
you
up.
You think my ratings back?
Jesus.
Everybody's Christ. Fucked up.
It's because he's fucking you. He's getting. It's work. He's fucking up his rating. He's got the disease.
Jesus.
The low bar disease.
Wow, dude. Man. It's worse than COVID.
James Cameron in this house. James Cameron, the pioneer. He needs to raise the bar in the Carrillo house, evidently.
Well, I will say this. It's not, you're not going to waste an evening. You're not going to waste an hour 45 watching this movie. You will spend it. but it's a good movie with respect to what they were trying to do with that Sonyverse at large. Because there is, you know, after credit scenes that are important to where you think they're going to be going with all this. So there's that.
I read the spoilers for the after credit scenes mm-hmm. and yeah, I wasn't excited. I was actually confused how they're trying to play off from No Way Home from the way it sounds.
The multiverse mm-hmm. cracking.
So I'll just save my comments until I can actually watch it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, let's get on to some bulletin stuff.
Oh, okay.
And you know, there are some things in the bulletin that will piss you off, Foo. I'm not going to lie. In this particular case, it involves none other than our favorite anime, Attack on Titan.
Oh, right.
So, today...
They're taking the Walking Dead method.
Yes. Yes, they are, sir. Yes, they are. So, today, as a recording, they released episode 87, the season finale of part 2 of the final season.
Right.
So, let's backtrack a little here. From where they are in this episode, they are on chapter 130 of the manga.
All right.
The manga ends on 139.
Okay.
So, when this episode was going to air last week and even the week before, I kind of told you guys, I'm like, I don't think they're going to be ending this series like we all think they are.
Yeah, because you said they're nowhere near being the end.
Nowhere near. Like, yeah. In fact, the 9 episodes alone can take up about an hour and a half of content. Maybe even 2 hours, depending on how much information they want to put into that. And there was already speculation that there was going to be an Attack on Titan movie. No one really knew what the hell it was going to be about, since there's no, like, extra stories being made by Isayama, the writer of... Attack on Titan. So we finally got an answer today. After today's episode air, they announced that part three of the final season will be premiering in 2023, Foos. And...
So don't lie to me. Yeah. And tell me that there's a final season.
Well, no, it's still the final season, but part three. But part three.
I hate so much about the things that you choose to be.
Yeah. And a lot of speculation is that the animators, MAPPA, that they needed to give themselves more time to end the series off properly because they have several other animes that they are working on coming up. They have Jujutsu Kaisen. The next season's coming up this fall.
And they just came out with the movie.
They just came out the movie Zero, and that is actually... I heard it was really good. Yeah, I read the manga version of that, mm-hmm. and it's pretty dope. If you haven't seen what Jujutsu Kaisen is, Foo, it's pretty much about sorcerers exercising a bunch of demons.
All right,
and it's gnarly as shit because you see like demons transfigure and morph humans into these or eat them alive. It's pretty gruesome.
Nice.
So I think you would actually appreciate it and like it.
Where is this?
It's on HBO Max, actually. You can find the first season on HBO Max, and season two will also be premiering there as well.
Tight.
And Crunchyroll. And then I believe they have another anime coming out. I think it's Black Clover or I think My Hero, one of them. But that's they're saying that is the reason that they are delaying the firm finale. And then also this anime finale is going to be different from what us manga readers got. So I will kind of explain the differences once they actually, you know,
happen.
Once it happens, mm-hmm. when it actually fucking, who knows when it's going to happen. But you guys are finally experiencing what me and the Foo felt every time there was a sudden delay in the manga release because they only released them a month at a time.
Wow.
And then 1 month we didn't like we waited on, I think they usually premiered on like on the 19th or 20th.
Mm-hmm.
We're like, where did you guys see a chapter? Is there a chapter? No, there's no chapter. Wait, what? Like we had to wait, like there was a 2 month break period. And so it just gets annoying. And I'm already pretty annoyed. I just want to see the end already. I want to see it animated since we all know what fucking happens, at least us manga readers. But
you think they'll change it?
They said they were. They said it's going to be drastically different because a lot of the, a lot of the readers of the manga were really pissed off at the ending.
Oh.
Yeah.
So they're trying to do a course correction.
They're trying to do course correction with the anime. Right. So,
Round two.
That is the only reason why I'm still invested. I want to see what type of course correction they will be making in the anime. So I'll show you guys I can put up on our screen in the living room the little manga so that we can just do like a quick read. It's pretty quick.
Spoiler alert, they don't change anything.
Oh, you bastards. You sons of bitches.
Oh, here. I'll do stupid.
Motherfuckers. And then we also had we're having Sonic 2 come out next week, Foos.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to be taking my nephew and my little sisters to go watch it.
You mean Jim Carrey's last movie?
Jim Carrey's last movie, Foo. And you know what? I would not hate seeing this as his last movie.
You know?
Because it's fitting. Good run. Yeah. It's fitting, man.
It's good.
It's fitting.
Yeah.
You know?
The first Sonic was great.
Yeah, well, I rewatch it a lot.
I was pleasantly surprised.
Yeah.
It was so good.
I like how they did that. And I'm really excited to see Knuckles come into play along with Tails. So, yeah, April 8th on Friday. You can also catch an early fan release they're doing on the 6th, as well as, you know, catch it on Thursday nights as well. That'll premiere. And then, Foo, lastly, we have some other sad news. We did lose. Mm-hmm. We lost a great man. We lost a great comedic actress. None other than Estelle Harris. Mrs. Costanza.
Yeah, it's true.
She left us this last
week. The Costanzas are now
annoying. They're annoying the shit out of everyone else in heaven. Frank and Estelle are arguing about what bras are made out of. Like a spandex, get out of here.
He's trying on his man's ear.
His man's ear. The bro.
Yeah.
It's the bro. Yeah, man. And, you know, that hit me hard because I'm a diehard fan of Seinfeld. I actually just watched the episode where they first introduced her as It's George's mom, and it's the one where she catches him masturbating in the bathroom.
That's the first one?
That's the first appearance of Estelle Harris, because like we see her in the hospital. And we don't see Frank's appearance until the handicap episode, where they park in the handicap spot.
But even... no, I'm thinking of Jerry's dad was different in season one, right?
And yes, Jerry's dad was different in episode one. Uh-huh. I think episode one, and then they changed him in episode two.
Okay, yeah.
And George's dad was not originally, what the hell's his name? Jerry Stiller. It was actually someone named John Randolph. When they first premiered it, it was a different Frank Costanza. And then after that, they reshot the scenes for syndication.
Uh-huh.
And that's why we see them now as Jerry Stiller.
Okay.
So if you have like the DVD versions of Seinfeld, you probably have the version with the original actor.
Mm-hmm.
So all of the ones that are like on Netflix or even that they show on TV, those are all the ones that you see with Jerry Stiller.
Hmm.
And then after that, at the behest of Larry David, they kept Jerry Stiller because he just fit the role perfectly.
Yeah. They had a good dynamic.
Yeah. So it's sad.
I mean, you understand why George is the way he is because he has those parents.
My favorite episode is when he has to talk to the apartment committee about upgrading to this new apartment,
mm-hmm.
and he's going up against the Andrea Doria survivor, a guy that survived a shipwreck. And so what he uses to, you know, plead his case that he is much more of a, you know, a sympathy case, if anything,
okay.
he tells them the life story of himself. And you just see the people are crying that he wore a dress, like he wears a dress as a kid until he was four. His parents would change him. He was not potty trained until he was 8 years old.
Wow.
And oh man, it just goes on from there. But you just see that, holy shit, that explains why this dude is the way he is. Oh, and then at the very end, he's just like, oh, yes, right. And to top it off, my fiance died because of invitations that I picked out, that they were old and toxic. So bid you farewell. And he walks out the door and they're all crying. It's like, oh God.
Yeah. Wow.
Oh God. Yeah. Yeah. So RIP, rest in paradise, Estelle Harris.
Yeah.
You will be missed. And I'm going to be watching a lot of your episodes after this.
Yeah. RIP, bro. What else we got? Is that it?
I think that's it.
All right, well, everybody stick around for a real quick joint report. We'll be right back.
Nerd! For something as uniquely crafted as your eye, you should have lenses made with the most care and precision to give you the highest quality of vision. Our mission is to provide you with the most optimal and modern eye care to ensure just that. That's why we're locally owned and operated with our very own digital processing lab engineered to see every detail imaginable. At Farsighted, we are proud to be the very first to bring this technology to our customers so that you can clearly see people's bullshit. Farsighted. Call them out on it.
Are you on weed? Give me some. I'll smoke you two under the table.
So, do they take PPO food?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Sweet. I need that. I need to catch some of y'all fuckers' bullshit in this room.
Cash these hands, man. So I just had a quick marijuana moment article here that I wanted to share with you guys. Now, this one's not so new, but I guess just maybe about a week ago, the U.S. Senate unanimously approves marijuana reform bill on the same day that the House schedules legislation vote. So the Senate is looking to like at least have some restrictions or just update their laws around it. But the House is currently working on providing a bill to just legalize it altogether.
what I'm hearing about this is that it's going to be real tough to get the whole thing legalized through the Senate, because there's no, we would need a considerable amount of votes coming from the Senate, so that it, and it's just not happening right now. So I think that because the Senate is doing what it's doing, they're really just softening the blow. So they're not really going to legalize it. Mm-hmm. It's just more like they're.
It's like
they're making it more fair.
Precursor,
yeah,
essentially.
And I don't know why they don't, man. We're in kind of like dire times right now, where we would need, you know, some kind of steady income coming in through like a different source that isn't really screwing over the citizens.
Yeah.
What do you think? I mean, do you think this would pass within the next 5 to 10 years?
I hope it'll pass within the next 5, but 10 is a much more realistic number, considering how many more states we have that are legalizing it.
Yeah.
Dude, eventually it's just going to end up being like 40 states out of in the U.S. are going to be legal. And at that point...
The problem, though, there is that are they going to be able to transport across state lines because it's still federally illegal?
But I think at that point, that's when they really need to consider just pushing it through.
Yeah.
You know, if we keep getting more and more states that legalize it, you know, eventually it's almost like strongholding them, strong-arming them. Mm. You know, so I would hope it's getting to that point. But, I mean, shit, we may even be like 15, dude. You know?
Yeah, yeah. And, well, just to tell you more about this bill, it's sponsored by Dianne Feinstein of California, Brian Schatz of Hawaii, Chuck Grassley of, what's IA, Iowa? Sure.
Yeah, Iowa.
It's titled the Cannabidiol and Marijuana Research Expansion Act. Apparently, it cleared the full chamber unanimously without a debate. It would streamline the application process for researchers who want to study the plant and to encourage the Food and Drug Administration to develop cannabis-derived medicines. It would also clarify that physicians are allowed to discuss the risks and benefits of marijuana with patients and require the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services to submit a report on those potential health benefits, as well one on barriers to cannabis research and how to overcome those obstacles. So, yeah, it seems like they want to study it more. They want to see how it can help people medically, health-wise. They just want to learn more from it, and the current laws really just won't allow that.
Just sounds like they're making more excuses, Foo, for not immediately legalizing it. Because they've had plenty of years already to do some research mm-hmm. and to get that data. So... yeah, get your heads out your asses, man. Just do it.
Yeah.
Just do it.
And of course, I don't... one thing that's resonating a lot, I think, with the public, that if they end up legalizing it, or at least decriminalizing it, what's going to happen to those who have records mm-hmm. of, you know, being arrested or being sent to prison because they were caught with maybe like a gram of weed in a very aggressively anti-marijuana state, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is that going to be expunged? Like, what's going to happen to those people?
And they should. Yeah, I think that was one of the big arguments about going or voting for, mm-hmm. you know, Brandon and Kamala. God. Yeah.
Yeah, dude. So, I don't know. Just one thing, because I first read a similar article on April 1st, and I'm like, oh, great, here we go. Because mm-hmm. we hear something like this every year.
Yeah.
On April 1st. But according to the news, it's not a joke or a fake. Like, they're actually trying to do this over in Capitol Hill. So.
Well, Foo, thankfully, we're in the good old month. The good old green month, 420, so...
That's true. Mm-hmm. That's true. Mm-hmm. We'll see you in a few days for that. But that's all I had for the joint report, man. Up next, we got music. Stick around.
Smoke weed every day. Rock and roll. I
said a hit. I want to rock. Well, man, first and foremost, you talked about somebody who you looked up to passing away. I think we all looked up to this dude, Taylor Hawkins. And on my birthday, damn it.
Yeah.
Happy
birthday, Foo.
Yeah, I mean, we were all having a great time. We're just sitting around, just kind of talking, and then I get the notification on my phone. I show it to my drummer, Charles, and he's like, "The fuck out of here! Like, you're kidding!" Like, everybody was just in shock because he's the one who kind of said it out loud. He's like, yeah. "You're kidding." And I was like, "Yeah, dude." And then I shared the news with everybody else. And you, how did you feel? What did you think when you found out?
I was just kind of like, well, obviously, Foo, you know, my standard, defense mechanism is to just start joking. Mm-hmm. So that's immediately what I just started doing.
Yeah.
I was just started being facetious. But, as soon as it kind of hit me, I'm just kind of like, fuck. Like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, I was more interested in wondering how, finding out exactly how it happened. But goddamn, man, another drummer gone, and a great drummer at that.
Well, he contributed so much to rock and roll, man.
Yeah.
I mean, not only being in the Foo Fighters, but his collaborations with other artists, like he had Chevy Metal, he had another super group that he put together with what's that guitarist from Perry Farrell's band? Dave Navarro. Yeah, they were working together on something. And they were promoting all that stuff. It was like an album was going to get released. He was going to be really busy. And the Foo Fighters just started the worldwide tour. I think it was supposed to keep going for like another year and a half.
Yeah.
And they just got started with the Americas. So that, right, they were down in Chile and Lollapalooza. That was the very last show that they played before he passed in Colombia, we heard, right? Mm-hmm. So, by all accounts, at least the toxicology report is saying that they found a few substances in his body. It could have been some, but they're not saying what actually killed him. I haven't heard any news. I don't know.
Yeah,
if you have.
I haven't heard anything being disclosed. They just said it was foreign substances, potentially drugs.
But it all impacted his heart. Like it said, it was heart failure or something like that. No.
Yeah.
So, yeah, man. So it hit me hard, particularly because Foo Fighters is one of the bands I look up to the most. And then I just felt so bad for like a guy like Dave who drums for his best friend's band, who passes away, becomes a front man for his own band, has a drummer who becomes his best friend, and then now he passes away.
Yeah, man. Ugh.
Yeah, it's awful to think about. And then his family, his kids. I've been watching a lot of clips online, like Rolling Stone did an interview with him, if I remember correctly. And I think the interviewer wanted to kind of take the conversation into like his drug use history. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe at least just being trying to be funny about it. But at a certain point, Taylor Hawkins is like, my son's going to read this. I really don't want to talk about any of that. Let's talk about, more positive stuff.
Right.
So it seems like, he might have already had some kind of substance issue that he was just not, but he was doing so well, mm-hmm. With it. And by all accounts, I think from some of my friends, Caesar and Sandra, who've been on this show before, were saying that in recent interviews, he kind of looked pretty frail. And so, with some of the pictures that I saw out there, he looked a little frail, but who knows, man? I mean, you can get pretty crazy down there in South America if you make the wrong connections.
Mm-hmm.
But I just feel so bad for him and his family, his band, his music. But he left a lot. Like, he left us a lot. And so I wanted to play just a clip. I won't play the whole thing. It's rather long. But his very last performance was on the 18th of March, according to this. It was at the Lollapalooza event over in Chile. And this is pretty much the Foo Fighters show that really kind of highlights Taylor for a few minutes.
Taylor Hawkins on the drums tonight. Look at that motherfucker. Taylor.
David.
Listen.
Yes.
Dan, light him up. Let me see all the people right now.
See? They love you, man.
Feel it.
Okay. Here's the thing. Taylor Hawkins, best fucking drummer in the world. Taylor Hawkins, best fucking singer in the world. Taylor Hawkins is going to come down and sing a song for you tonight.
That was awesome, Samir.
Everybody dance now. You guys want to hear Dave Grohl play the fucking drums?
Oh, fucking ads. I can only scream over them. There we go.
Yeah.
The best part about getting to be the lead singer of the Foo Fighters just for one song is I really do have the greatest rock and roll drummer on the planet Earth. He ain't cheap. He ain't cheap.
He ain't cheap.
He's worth it. You're gonna get your solo, don't you fucking worry. Dave Grohl? I'm not gonna do that to you anymore. You wanna play a Queen song, Dave? No? Oh, there it is.
Yeah, man, the guy had pipes. Like, yeah. He can sing. He can do it all, man. He was just such a talent, and it just hurts that we've lost such a talent. But we got to remember how much he left us. You know, he did so much while he was here. And man, the marathons on the radio and all the tributes that they've been pretty awesome.
Yeah, man, and it's sad because you're never gonna see this instance of the Foo Fighters ever again.
No.
And
yeah, they'll never be the same.
You know, I'm interested in seeing how they recover, if they recover from this. Mm-hmm. Yeah, man, it hits hard. And you know what, man, I'm not a musician by any means.
Yeah.
You know, I can't really play an instrument. I can, you know, hit a beat every once in a while, but nothing to the effect of like these actual guys. But I'm a music aficionado,
right?
And drummers particularly, and he was always one of my favorite, you know, along with Travis Barker, mm-hmm. and Dave Grohl, obviously. But yeah, man, it really sucks.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I just wonder what's going to happen. Yeah, the Foo Fighters just canceled their entire tour. They canceled their appearance on the Grammys, which is happening tonight as we record this. And so who knows, are the Foo Fighters going to continue without him? Because he was part of that formula.
Yeah. I mean, I can see friends, you know, jumping in to, you know, fill in, like Josh Homme. I can see him jumping in,
yeah,
on the drums, mm-hmm. you know, filling in. Yeah. Yeah, man. Ugh. Yeah. It sucks, dude.
Yeah. So, I will wait and see. Obviously, you know, they have to grieve. We all do.
Yeah.
And it's a process, man. You can't expect them just to get back to work.
Yeah.
Just so quickly.
Yeah.
But, I mean, shoot. I mean, when Scott Weiland passed, which is another one that kind of got me pretty bad when that happened, they took a few years off. You know, what was it? Probably like 5 years later, they started touring with this new guy.
Yeah, yeah. I remember. So. I remember when that happened, because that happened on my birthday.
Yeah,
when Scott Weiland passed.
Oh, good God.
Yeah, just like, God damn.
We can't escape these on our birthday.
That one sucked too, because yeah, I was in the car when I heard the news, and me and my brother Carl were like, "What the fuck? No!" Yeah. Like, oh God.
But his drug problem was way more visible.
Yeah, yeah. So his wasn't as much of a surprise, but it still hit.
It stung. Yeah.
This just fucking was like smacked us like this, like, you know, Will Smith smacked.
It really
Chris
took
Rock.
The breath, like the, yeah. the air out of the room.
Yeah.
When we learned about the passing of the great Taylor Hawkins. But yeah, I just wanted to spend some time talking about him, because man, we're never gonna see a light like that in rock and roll. But you know, we'll move on here. In going back to the carousel of genres that we are all assigned, this week I was assigned rock.
And I picked this song by an artist called The Luka State. This is a single called Oxygen Thief. I think it's a pretty rocking tune. Check it out. Yeah, this one's always making my playlist when I drive around town with this song on. It's pretty cool, man. I'm looking forward to checking more of their stuff out. They kind of remind me of like a really like a faster Bush.
Yeah. Okay. You know? I see that.
There it is.
That vibe, right?
Heard that before.
Good stuff. Good stuff. Moving on to, I believe this is you, Josh. You picked one by an artist called Dave.
Yeah, so, you know, scrolling Dave. Through and
you got hip-hop?
I had hip-hop.
Hip-hop, R&B, or something of the like?
Yeah, hip-hop. Yeah. And this is Dave. He's a British rapper / singer. This is his hit single, Starlight.
All right.
It's hard to hate on the truth, I'm living enough, man hate with the lies instead. Counting cash with a phone to my ear, I feel like Meek on a private jet. Life or death, 5-5, eyes, fires, potential wifey. In the street, respected highly, in the street, protected. I do know my man, but I don't trust him. Trust that bees in the trap, disgusting, stick with a stick. PVA, PDA, kiss that in public, South London. Why I made my South London's, why I made my first 100 elastic bands. Plastic bags, two in a blue like cheese and onion. In Jamaica, quick vacation, traveling my pastime. Enough pollution in the ends, I flew back York, I wanna see Starlight. Eritrean skin tone cinnamon, I think I found my princess. My empress still gonna impress. I know them man talking a kid, but it's hard to hate on the truth. I'm living enough, man hate with the lies instead. Counting cash with a phone to my ear, I feel like Meek on a private jet. Life or death, 5-5, eyes, fires, potential wifey. In the street, respected highly. In the street, protected. Any girl that I'm dating knows. Bags that I buy come filled.
I like that's a clever use of Frank Sinatra's Fly Me to the Moon.
Yeah, it is, huh? Yeah, yeah. That's why I like the beat that he picked on the back, and he has good flow. You know, I'm actually liking a lot of these new British rappers that are coming out. Pop Smoke was another good one who had passed a few years back. So I'll try to introduce more of these. Yeah.
Nice. Cool. Steph, you had Pop this week. Uh-huh. You picked one by Fulton Lee. I've never heard of this.
So artist. He's based out of Nashville, Tennessee, mm-hmm. and he categorizes himself as like a bubblegum funk pop.
No.
Uh-huh.
And this song actually just came out last month in March. Okay. So it's a relatively new song. And
this one's called White Skates. Check this out.
Hey! Another follow in the flame. The boy was secondhand in names. The people said it was lame. Somebody happened to exaggerate it, baby. But then from the start, they was talking about their brother without crossing their heart. It was in love. Be
you said it was considered bubblegum funk?
Funk pop.
Funk pop. That's probably the best description
yeah.
to this that I've, that anybody can come up with. That's awesome. No, yeah, it's a real funky tune. Reminds me of Vulpec.
A little bit, right? Little with the bit. Staccato guitar.
And the yeah, and the little falsetto vocals in there. What's funk? You know, they're going to use that. I like it. Good. Yeah. All right. Well, here's one I just wanted to highlight. This I also consider this one to be the comic relief. This is by an artist called Tom Cardy. He has an album called Artificial Intelligence, and this one stood out to me because the name of the song is H.Y.C.Y.Bh. Or it's it stands, have you checked your butthole?
When my roommate comes into the room looking for his car keys, I don't say it yet. And when he gets me off the couch to check underneath the couch cushions, I don't say it yet. No. And then when he says out loud, I wonder where my car keys are, I still don't say it. But then he asks me, do you know where my car keys are? I look at him in his face and I say, have you checked your butthole? Skid up, butthole. I have not seen your keys, but since you're asking me, you better check up that butthole. I'm not serious, I don't think it's up inside your big brown business. But a funnier thing to say to someone who's lost their shit and is stressed out visibly, when I see the best man start to sweat, I don't say it yet. When I see that little ring bearer cunt getting yelled at by his mum, oh, I still don't say it. When I see the groom asking the vicar if they can wait just another 15 minutes, I do not say it. And when the father of the bride starts organising an ad hoc emu bob of the courtyard area, I want to, but I do not say it. It's the 11th hour with 300 congregants under God's roof. The vicar approaches the mic and suddenly all of the chatter goes mute. He says that they've misplaced the rings. Could anyone possibly know where they are? I know it's my time and all heads turn as I stand and say, vicar, have you checked your phone?
You know where this is going.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is
he a proctologist?
Have you checked your butthole? Remember back in the day when the answer to practically everything in this kind of scenario would always be like up your butt around the corner?
Yeah.
Oh,
up
man.
Your butt around the corner.
Up around the corner, man.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's gonna do it for. I didn't have it this week in history because that was pretty much the Taylor Hawkins thing.
Yeah, we didn't need anything else, Foo.
Yeah, man. Well, that's here. Let me get the old little sound effect here. Yeah, and that's gonna do it for the show, man. Next week, just a little programming news. We have Dianthus coming on the show. They're they're twins, two ladies who play metal, and I really enjoy their stuff. Steph introduced me to their music. I was checking it out in the car the other day. Really melodic kind of metal music, and I'm excited to have the both of them on. We're going to be doing a Zoom call,
okay,
and so we can kind of record out of order. Yeah, bro, we'll I know this is news to you, Josh, so we'll talk about the logistics.
Everything's news to me, man. That's fine.
Last one to know.
Yeah.
It's okay.
It's fine.
It's fine.
I don't pay attention anyways.
So. Yeah, yeah. let's see what else is happening. Oh, yeah. Fucking chime in. If you're listening and you follow us on Instagram, you can always send us a direct message with maybe like a voice thing. If you want to talk some shit, we'll play it.
Tell us how you feel about Steph's review of Morbius for those of you that have watched it. And tell us if you will be listening to our reviews from here on out.
That's really what I care about.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, yeah.
Hey, people are going to be on my side.
70%
of
people.
That's why
I'm not knocking your
opinion. I'm in the majority here.
Yeah, you are.
Again, that is why we would like to listen to you, you know, hear from you listeners. Help Steph, you know, not seem crazy
help
to the Alexis.
Help you.
She is your voice. Yeah. Voice of a generation.
And let's see. Just a reminder, click on that grass store banner at the bottom of foobarshow.com. And then just a reminder that I will be at 3rd Street Bar on April 8th. That's this coming Friday. Show starts at 7. And yeah, we're going up at 9, so we got a prime spot there. And it's fun, man. It's been fun being a three-piece band.
Yeah.
It's been real fun being a three-piece band. I would love to have a bassist up on stage with us, but it's working out. Would you not agree, Steph? You've gone to those shows.
You guys look so much more energetic now that you're a three-piece.
Yeah, well, we have all this elbow space on stage now. Like, there's more space on stage.
You
so
have
we
just sandals laying around everywhere.
All right. All right.
Oh, no, too far?
We don't know. No, far? No, it's not. Oh. It's not. Oh, okay. It's just we don't have to.
Wait, we don't talk about Bruno?
I'm just not interested in talking shit about the guy, okay?
I didn't name names. Just saying. Just saying, dog.
All right. But it's been fun. Okay. It's been fun. And those who come out to watch us have been saying, yeah, you guys are looks like you're having fun up there. So
nice.
I'm glad that it's coming off the way I had planned. Because what's happening for those, I mean, I'm going to peel back the curtain.
No,
for a
no.
Don't do it. Don't do it.
I recorded the bass tracks.
Oh.
What? What did you think I was going to say?
I don't know.
Oh.
Hold on. Are there more secrets that I don't know about?
No, well, I recorded all the bass tracks, and then on top of that, I recorded some backup vocals. I recorded keys and organs.
It's like
we're a five-piece band, really, when you're listening to us.
Eventually, it's just going to be Foosie over here as the DJ.
Yeah, it's just going to be me karaoke.
I am the fallen electric. Press play. And he's just like...
Yeah.
No, hands in the air.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's your boy,
Josie.
Yeah, no.
On the tippity top.
Imagine it just becomes that. It's like Studio 666 where Dave Grohl just kills his bandmates. And he's just a solo artist.
No, I picture you like Dick Van Dyke's character in Mary Poppins where you have just everything all on your back. Oh.
One man band.
Yeah. But yeah, come check us out, man. This one in particular is going to be just a 30-minute set. But if you really want to get a good taste of us, we do 4-hour shows. We got plenty of those coming up too, so I'll announce those as we go. But thank you all very much for listening to the Foo Bar Show. Remember to hit subscribe and be sure to rate, review, and tell a friend like a freaking champion. You can also listen in and get our swag at foobarshow.com. That's foobarshow.com. And follow FOO Bar Show on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Instagram. Join in, drop us a line, and we'll foo it up like a couple of foos. I've been Josie.
I've been Josh.
And Steph.
Signing off, saying...